Hello and welcome back to Excelsure Academy. Myself, Dr. Ruby Singh. So this is the solutions which are prepared for the MCQs which were asked on the telegrams. So let's solve all these questions. So the first question is, the enormous diversity of protein molecule is due to the diversity of what? So this is very clear because as we have studied about all these amino acid structures, we see that everything is common over here. You have got your COOH, that is your acidic group. Then you have got the amino group and the H. So what is varying is only the R group, the side chain. So more the difference in the side chain, the more difference you see in your protein diversity. So if we see the following options, we see that we have got the R group of amino acid, amino group of amino acid. So amino group of amino acid is going to remain same for all the amino acids. Peptide bond is common for again all the proteins present. Amino acid sequence within the protein molecules. So from all this, what we understand is, it is the R group of amino acid which brings about the more variety, more diversity in the proteins. Okay, so here hence the answer is R group of amino acid. Let's move on to the next. Which of the following are water soluble proteins? So we have got the option as globulins, albumins, albuminoids, and prolamins. So it's very easy because in our system, in the blood circulatory system, in the blood system, which protein is maximum present? It can be asked in that way also. So we know that it is albumin. And albumin is present in most percentage in your blood system. So from here, these are not your water soluble proteins. Only albumins is your water soluble proteins. Next, among the following acidic amino acids are glycine and alanine. No, it is not. Valine and phenyl, no. Again, they are aromatic as well as the hydrophobic amino acids. Glycine and methionine, no. What we have is glutamic acid and aspartic acid. The name itself suggests that they are the acidic amino acids. Hence, the answer is D. So these are very few simple questions which were asked in the previous years. For example, in the IIT JAM and the NEET. So let's move on to the next question. The sulfur containing amino acid. This is very simple. If you remember the classification of all these proteins, like how they have been arranged, right? Based on the polarity, based on the charges, based on the side groups and all. So you remember that the sulfur containing amino acids are only two, and those are cysteine and methionine. So only these two amino acids are there which has got the sulfur present in them. So let's see what all options we have. We have got valine, leucine, methionine and histidine. So now we know that the answer is methionine. So it's very simple if you remember the classification. And aromatic amino acids. So this I have explained in the previous lecture also that there are three aromatic amino acids. There are three aromatic amino acids which are responsible for, if this is a wavelength and this is the intensity, fluorescence intensity, then what we see is that from 400, not sorry, sorry, sorry. So what we see that from 200 to 400, that is your UV range, we see that around 280 nanometer, we get a maximum absorption. And all these absorption is because of those three aromatic amino acids. So what are those three aromatic amino acids? Phenylalanine, tyrosine, and tryptophan. So let's see what are the options given. So we have got tryptophan, yes. Tyrosine, yes. And phenyl. So from here, the answer is all of these. So all these questions, what we are going through now, it's only on one concept, that if you remember the proper classification of amino acids, and the question becomes very easy to solve. Next, a peptide bond formation between two amino acids is accompanied by dash. This is also, again, a very simpler way to explain is that, if you remember, that it is the condensation process by which a peptide bond is formed. Okay, so let's see how it is formed. So we have got amino acids. Let's draw the structure of amino acid. So we have got the amino acid structure. Let it be some R1 group. Okay, and then we have got the another amino acid H and R2. Okay. Now, if we have to see like how exactly it is formed, what we have to see is that, as mentioned before, that the amino group of one amino acid will attack as nucleophilic. Okay. So this is going to act as your nucleophilic profile, and it is going to attack on the hydroxyl group of the carboxyl present on the first amino acid. So what will happen? HOH will form H2O. So with this loss of water, a peptide bond is formed. Now, how does the peptide bond will look like? It will look like C double bond O N H. So this is your peptide bond. Now let's see what are the options given. So a peptide bond formation between two amino acids is accompanied by loss of water. Yes, as we have seen right now that there is a loss of water, and it is also called condensation process. Deamination, no amino group was removed. Addition of water, no, nothing was added. And decarboxylation, no, again. So answer is loss of water. I hope this is clear. Now move on to the next. Now, if all the peptide bonds of a protein are broken down, then what would remain? Okay, so what does it mean? What the question is asking is, if the peptide bonds of a protein, so we know that, let us say that we have got amino acid 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on, many are there, okay? N number of amino acids are there making a one particular protein. Now, the question is, the peptide bonds of a protein are broken down. So it means that they are saying all the peptide bonds are broken over here, here, here. Let it be enzymatic, let it be a chemical treatment which leads to breaking of all the peptide bonds. So what will happen? If all is the question, then it cannot be peptides, because peptides still have the peptide bond. Polypeptides, oligopeptides, no, but because again they contain some number of peptide bonds. So hence the answer is amino acids. It has to be remaining only with the amino acids, because they are individual molecule, not bound with any peptide bonds. Moving on to the next, the example of scleroprotein are dash. Now this is a kind of derivative proteins. Okay, so here options are keratin, fibroin, and options. So actually, scleral protein means both fibrous as well as the keratin. So here the answer is both A and B. Yes. Which of the following is a conjugated protein? Mucin, MHC. So MHC stands for major histocompatibility complex. Okay. Immunoglobulins and all of these. So if you see, actually all these proteins are having some kind of the other prosthetic group present in that. So hence the answer is all of these over here. The contractile protein in the human body is dash. So we know that in the muscle contraction, actin, myosin, and tubulin, all these three proteins are working in order to help the muscle undergo contraction. So hence all the contractile protein here are the answer. So all of these again is the answer. The most abundant protein in the whole of the biosphere is dash. So if you see over here, collagen is present wherever the connective tissue are there. Okay. So let's assume that we are considering all the humans present and all the animals present on the earth and their connective tissue having the collagen. Insulin, again, talking about all the animals as well as the humans. trypsin again. Now, talking about the rubisco, rubisco is present in all photosynthetic plants. Now, if you compare which among these are maximum or mostly abundant on earth, is it the animals, humans, or the plants? So, obviously, the answer is plants. Hence, the answer is rubisco. So, rubisco is the most abundant protein in the whole of the atmosphere. Primary structure of protein is due to dash. So, the primary structure of protein is due to, so already we know that the amino acids are joined together with the help of the peptide bonds, and that is the how it is forming the primary structure, that is a polypeptide bond is formed. So here the answer is peptide bonds. A peptide chain assumes secondary structure through the formation of dash, interchain ionic bonds, hydrogen bonds. Peptide chain with peptide bonds only is a secondary structure itself, none of the above. So here the option C doesn't make sense, because peptide chain with peptide bond only is a secondary structure. No, we have studied already that the secondary structures are alpha and beta sheets, alpha helices and beta sheets, and they are formed with the help of the hydrogen bondings, right? Now, to form a secondary structure, you need the formation of hydrogen bonds within the polypeptide chain. Hence, the answer becomes intra-chain hydrogen bonds. Okay, for example, let's see the structure of alpha helices. So, the hydrogen bond is formed between the amino acid 1 to the amino acid 4. Okay, so this is how a hydrogen bond is formed and the alpha helices are formed. Okay, moving on to the next. In alpha helices, secondary structure, the hydrogen bonds lie between amide group of one amino acid and the carbonyl group of dash. Just now I have mentioned that it is the first and to the fourth amino acid. So here the answer is C, fourth amino acid. The hydrogen bond is formed between the first and the fourth amino acid in the alpha helices. Now, which of the beta protein is stable in nature? So, once we discuss about all these beta pallor sheets, there are two types, beta antipallor and beta pallor sheets. If you see the structure over here and also analyze the structures of the proteins, you see that in the case of beta pallor, it is present like this, okay? And in the case of antipallor, it is present like this. So, any protein which is having beta antipallor, they become more stable as compared to the beta pallor. Okay, so here the answer is beta antipallor. This will be more clear once you start studying the 3D structure of proteins. So you see over there that the most of the proteins which takes the conformation of the secondary and tertiary structure, they have got the beta antipallor sheets. Now, quaternary structure is present in dash. This many a times I have discussed in the online sessions also, that it is your hemoglobin which has got the quaternary structures, whereas rest of the protein has got the tertiary structure. It's a single domain molecule, whereas in the case of hemoglobin there are four subunits. Now, quaternary structure is found in dash, simple monomeric proteins, conjugate monomeric proteins, oligoproteins, or both B and C. So what will be the answer over here? You cannot have quaternary structure in the case of simple monomeric proteins, because it is going to have only the tertiary. And to become a quaternary, you need the association of other proteins also. So you can have the answer as conjugate monomeric proteins, where you can have the prosthetic group also attached to that. Each molecule of fat has dash, one glycerol molecule, one fatty acid, one glycerol molecules and three fatty acid molecules, and all of the above. So here, if you remember the structure of fatty acid, it is the one glycerol molecules and three fatty acid molecules which forms the one fat. Okay, and that's why it is also called triacylglyceride. And that's why it is called triacylglyceride, where you have got the three fatty acids molecule. Now, which of the following is a saturated fatty acids? It's very simple, because on table has been shared in the lecture series, and it shows very clearly that the stearic acid is the only saturated fatty acids, and rest all belongs to the family of unsaturated fatty acids. So these are your unsaturated fatty acids. Okay. So now we are coming close to the end of this MCQ. The last question is, fatty acid contains dash. Greater proportion of oxygen than in carbohydrates? No, it is not true. And what is the, see, here I would like to explain one point is that we all know that fats gives maximum energy, right, as compared to carbohydrates and proteins. Now, why they give maximum energy? Because maximum oxygen is utilized in order to break the bonds, and hence gives the maximum energy. So it doesn't have the greater proportion of oxygen. It does have the oxygen, but not equal to carbohydrate. So hence the answer is, it cannot be greater, it cannot be less, and it is, the absence is also not there. So we have answer is less oxygen than in the carbohydrates. And that's why we need more energy. That's why we get more energy when we break down the fat molecules. So this was the last questions. I hope you like the discussion of these sessions. So please join us on Telegram also to get more questions on the biochemistry topics. These are very simple. With the syllabus covered, we are going to do more questions, and it will be very good for your preparation of the exams also. So let's be in touch and keep studying. So thank you for listening and watching. If you like the video, please share and subscribe. Let your friends also know, and let us study together. You can ask your doubts in the comment section also, or you can mail to us at excelsureacademy1228@gmail.com. I will be very happy, and I will also appreciate if you have your own topic for discussion. You can also suggest and comment to us, and I'll be very happy to make the videos on that. So keep watching and keep excelling with us, Excelsure Academy. Thank you.